Hello and welcome to Mystica. Now today I'm very honored to have a guest who is a mystic man, Mr. Lars Mohl. Hello.
Hello, Mohl. Thank you.
Very happy that you are here, and I'm excited because I love your books, I love your work, and wonderful that you are here in Munich. And yeah, good luck and much fun to this interview. Yeah, the mystic way, the spiritual path. You read wonderful books. You have a long way on your own spiritual path. And Lars Mohl, thank you again that you are here. I read about that you have the first experiences since your childhood. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
What? Yes. I'm positive that all of us have our first spiritual experiences. Yeah. When we're a child, mm-hmm. we're children. But I've experienced also too many people who have come to me and in need of help or advice or anything, that we seem to forget about it very quickly. Yeah. And often we are maybe told by our parents, well-meaning people around us, yeah. that we should not pay any attention to that kind of thing. So I think that is also part of my work today, in remembrance of this, to tell people, remember, try to go back and see how can you actually remember these things, because they have been there all the time. To me, it was very, very, because I was confronted with my little sister's death when I was 9, 10 years old. And that to me was a start of a whole new way of perceiving what it was to be on Earth suddenly and be here. And I also feel a lot of people who are actually working with spirituality have felt the same kind of estrangement to being here from a very early age on.
Yeah, so we are all spiritual people also.
Like, come from afar. And a lot of people come here for the first time, incarnate here for the first time, come from somewhere else. And they have certain duties to do here and certain experiences to do here. And very often a mix of both, because every time you have a task to do, you also having some experiences that you can learn from at the same time.
And also we have the normal life here with problems and things and new themes. And
the drama of life is something that is really challenging for most of us.
And to bring heaven and earth together, it's a long life work, isn't it?
Yeah. So that has been exactly the same for me as it has been for everybody else. Mm-hmm. I have just been confronted with it in a very... what do you call it? You know, like.
What happened there? What?
She just, she had a brain tumor and she died. And to me, it was, of course, a shock, because we were very connected. Yeah. But in some very innocent kind of way, at one point, in a childish way, years before it happened, I had this. Oh, she was irritating me, and I was just thinking, I wish he weren't here. And suddenly she weren't here anymore,
And then you felt guilty or no?
Yeah, of course. Oh. I felt that this was my... And later on I started to reflect that you should be very careful for what you wish for.
Best thing not to wish anything.
I don't
maybe
know.
To wish, please help me, be my guide, dear God. This is a good wish, isn't it? What is the best wish we can do for our life?
I don't know. That's part question. Of the challenge, really. We can only wish to be to express the best part of who we are. The original self that we believe that we are here to discover, rediscover, because we
First to realize who am I, who we are.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
And what is my work here? What do I have to do? What is my light, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But at that time, because of that, it made me very vulnerable to everyday life. So I could not attend school. I could not go. And there were so many things that I had to go on my own and I had to do something. So my path had been a lonely one, really. Yeah.
A little bit like an alien feeling sometimes.
Mm, yeah.
I know this too.
I think a lot of people.
Yeah. And you had some Kundalini experiences as a child.
Yeah, but that's also something that I later get to know from the seer, my teacher, many years later, that this is also part of every human being's experience. But most,
it's not so holy, Kundalini.
It's not about holiness. It's about something that actually happens to you because of when we have a shock, for example. It doesn't have to be losing a member of your family. It can also be waking up and you find yourself alone in the house and you feel abandoned, for example. And that abandonedness have maybe, to you especially, something that you can remember from a former lifetime. And it made you tick on that special feeling. And maybe it's a shock you get from it. And in that moment, you will feel a release of what we call, what is called Kundalini. It's something that happens when you, every person who go into being a, when, you know, when Eros is awakened around 12, 13 years old, these things happens to everybody. And if you have a shock, my teacher told me, you will feel that in a way, it's like something, a veil is taken away and you are being very exposed to everyday life, to the world, to noise, to everything, other people's problems. To me, it meant that I was, it, that I was confronted with other people's pains and problems. I could also feel that when a people, when a grown up, an adult, was not speaking the truth.
Not you that, felt there's not something that, wrong.
Not that they were lying, but you know that there's, it's not, you know, in coherence with what that person really are, you know. It's a pretense, you know. You pretend to be something that you aren't. And that's very natural also for all of us, that at certain moments of our life, we are, we feel the need to try to project something that is not really us. But we learn from that, I feel. That's what we really learn from. But we need to also to see it in order to get rid of it or to transform it, you know, I think.
And on the spiritual way, sometimes it's the best thing to become nobody. Becoming nobody is a mystic thought. You felt a little bit alone and others like other people. And did you also felt guided by angels? Did you have the feeling, okay, it's fine, I go my way? Where did you get the security, the feeling that it's okay to be here and do with these experiences?
Both no and yes. I was, because I was really in a bad spot. Really, really. I felt really in strains and being not in connected to anything here. So it was really, really not, I was not good. But then another thing happened when, that was when a few years later, I got a book with a post from a an anonymous sender. I don't know to this day who sent me this book, but this is a small book of aphorisms of a Sufi master called Hazrat Inayat Khan.
Yeah, yeah.
And
Wonderful.
I opened it randomly, and the first thing that it came to me was, if you will approach us, we will bow down and lift you up. And to me, that was the help I needed right at that moment. So also, I have.
So that does mean that means we get help, but we have to do the first step that we get this help.
Or? I don't know. Somebody sent me that book.
Yeah. I mean the sentence what you talked about. Yeah.
Exactly. It was from the like the angels were talking to me.
We are guided, but we have to say, please help me, and then they come a little bit closer to us. Is that it?
But I also had another experience that was. That was a little bit before when I went into a church. I could not go to school, so I started to go into churches in my town in Aarhus, and find out when the organist was rehearsing and just sitting there having all this music. And that was part of my healing, and also you could call it my musical education through this music.
Yeah.
And. So one day I was in a church and there was no music there. I missed the time. I didn't have it right, you know. So I remember I was asking God if there in a prayer, if my sister, give me a sign if my sister is still there.
Mm.
And suddenly there was a kind of it was not a big thing, but I experienced it as a big thing. Mm. A small something came down through the air from the roof of the church and just lay in front of me like a small feather kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
And that was enough for me.
It
was
your really heart note, okay, this is my sign. Yeah. This is it. Yeah, yeah. Wow.
But I think this again, this is not a huge thing. I think this is how we are surrounded by these things all the time, and we are connected all the time if we want to, if we choose to be.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's our choice. We have to say, okay, I want to go this way. So the seer later told to you, you have the choice. You
can. Exactly.
What do you really want? Mm. Yeah. So, okay, later you became a very famous musician, rock musician also. So.
Famous and famous. I was in Denmark, you know, it's a small country.
So it was, I think, a very interesting career, but some years later you get very ill. And you were 2 years ill, is that right? And
then 3 years ill.
Yeah, wow.
Exactly. To be exact, you know, I went into music life because I did not know where else to go. I needed a place to be.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I was so fortunate to be together with some other boys that, like me, also needed a place to go.
Mm-hmm.
And what we had in common was we were all musical, but there was not really musical ambition as such. So we went on a trip to Israel in 1969 on a concert tour for 3 months. And what happened there was really those boys becoming a kind of young men there. It was an initiation. And to me, it meant that suddenly I discovered, I'm actually, tonight we are playing in Nazareth, tomorrow we are going to Bethlehem. Yeah. And before that we went to Jerusalem. You know, it was suddenly I was there because I was very much taken by the Jesus figure.
Yeah.
And that that vibe that later to me became Yeshua, which is the real name. And it was like, this is where you belong. This is, I could really resonate with it. And we went to the Dead Sea, to the place of the Qumran, of the old University of the Essenes. And immediately, the first time I stepped in there, it was like coming back to something I knew so strongly.
Yeah. Wow.
So, you know, everything kind of evolved. And
so it all comes together. There are not many accidents.
Ways, you know.
It happens from thing to thing.
Yeah. Exactly.
Wow.
So I feel so fortunate. I feel so grateful for everything that, even at the time when I did not understand it, you know, but in retrospectively, when I later, you know, that was why it happened.
Yeah.
And you start to find out how life works.
Yeah.
How everything works.
Yeah, yeah. Schopenhauer said, I look back into my life and I saw it's all from step to step like a plan. It's wonderful.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Wow.
And I think you are part of the plan by the choices you make.
Yes.
Hmm?
Yeah. And we don't know who does the plan, where does it come from, the plan of life.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, wow. Okay. And then you realize, okay, that's also a very important theme for me. And okay, something later, you get ill.
I spent all my the most of my life in showbiz, but that was again, of course, I was very much into music because you cannot be half there and half not.
Yes.
But at the same time, I was studying, and that became more and more important. Mm-hmm. That those studies was more and more became more and more took more and more of out of my. That was my real. My primary thing, you know. And again, at that time, I did not know I was actually preparing for what I'm doing today. Mm-hmm. But when I met Kalle, after, you know, as you said, I became sick and I went to, I lie on a bed more or less for 3 years. Mm-hmm. And nobody could diagnose me and so forth. But suddenly, through a friend, I was connected to Kalle. And within 5 minutes, he got me out of bed, so to speak. Over the telephone, and of course that was, you know, like a miracle to me. Mm. And in that half year before I was supposed to meet him, before I could meet him, so many things happened. I used to be a heavy smoker, and I tried so many times to quit smoking, but suddenly I was able to, with like just like this, and yeah. I just felt that something was building up, something was falling into place. I suddenly understood that everything I had been doing up to that, even being in showbiz, because some people said, wasn't it schizophrenic to be in showbiz and being, and you could say that, but at the same time, no, because the showbiz more or less took part of what you would call the Eros part of me.
Yeah.
While the other
creativity, also Kundalini power,
also, and you know, sensuality.
To play,
Sensuality in many ways, you know, of smell, of being, and start to to joining into life, because I've been so estranged, so it took me into, it forced me into be part of, you know, there was drugs, there was partying, there was everything, all the ordinary things of that, what you think. So, I became soaked up in a way, but at the same time, I had my studies, and slowly it took over more and more, and in the end, I felt just so estranged from everything that was in there. You should remember when I was young, I really wanted to be just normal, you know. I wanted to be so music in many ways, and being in some way made me part of ordinary
community
life,
you know, people like you and so
But you know, of course, a lot of projection is going on, but in many ways I feel that my life in showbiz made me ready to do my work also here, because now at that time I was very shy to go on stage. I was not a lead singer or something. I was just playing the organ, sitting doing my backing vocals, but learning a lot from it, you know. So it suddenly I became the lead singer, you know, and I was educated in how to go on stage to perform. So to me today, I don't have any problems going up there. I don't have to be
And all came together, and now you also do music, holy music, wonderful music for the people.
Yeah.
And but then your life changed more and more.
Yeah, and now, then I started to work with the Seer, of course.
So I think 9 years you was together with him, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you write down wonderful stories about him, and he led you to go to some holy places, and you learned more and more. How could you describe what was the changing, the most changing things in your life, in your psyche, in your spiritual way? What were the most important things, what you learned more and more?
From him?
Yes.
First of all, it was when I met him, I had been studying so much. I've read all the books, all the traditions, Taoism, you know, all the classic books that were to read. But I did not pay any attention to practice in a way that was deep enough, you know. It was very on the surface. I tried this, I tried that, and I had a very awkward feeling towards prayer, you know, because I did not know really what it was about and how. So I meet this guy who have not read anything really, yeah, but he'd done a lot of practice. Yeah. Meaning, mm-hmm, what kind of practice? Every morning he raised up from bed and he said, I hereby dedicate myself to the universe, God.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And he really, I could see he was really, you know, it was just not some words came out of his mouth, you know. Yeah. So despite, and I also find out that despite all his personal problems, every morning when he went into this work, into his office, and started working for other people, dedicating himself to other people, helping them with their sickness, and they were phoning him from all over the world. That seriousness, and that's what do you call it, when the way he dedicated himself to his work, that was really, really inspiring. And of course, again, at the time, I did not know before later on, oh yeah, this is the important thing. This is the important thing, that he really dedicated himself. He did not doubt at any moment that he could connect himself to what we, what you call God or whatever you want to call
it. Akasha Chronic or something.
It doesn't matter,
like
this, you know. We have all kinds of strange names for the same thing. But, you know, the seriousness from him and the humbleness and the soberness and the ethical thing about doing it. And when he left, when he went out, all his problems was waiting for him out there. And as he said one day, don't worry, Lars, they won't run away from you. They will wait there. Nobody will come and take it away from you. And so that, in that way, he was not the one who said, now I'm going to teach you something. It was by showing all the way by mostly of what he did.
So, so he was on his side, and you saw, for example, how he worked with the people on telephone, and he saw and realized all what their problems were. Like, it sounds like a wonder, but you learned more and more. It's a normal work.
He said, exactly like Jesus said before him, no comparison. Whatsoever, but if you do as me, everybody can do what I do. And I think that's the main thing that we understand, that we are, everybody is already enlightened beings. And I think that when people come and say to me, if you follow this course or if you do this and you pay this money,
End, then you'll
also be enlightened. And of course, I'm the one to decide when that's happening, you know, because I'm, of course, enlightened, you know. All this crap, it has to go. Because, so it's more or less people's own thoughts about how things are and how things aren't.
And how that, should I be when I'm holy and heal
I cannot sit in a lotus position. How can I do it? Or whatever, you know, it is, you know. And I think we have to get rid of that. Because Jesus is saying that if you follow my example, you can do even greater wonders than I. We just think about it. Just think about it. Have you ever heard something in the church preach? No. And that's really, really weird, because it's one of the strongest words in the whole New Testament, I think. That from this man, listen, it's actually there. Heaven is within you.
So
you can choose.
Make the choice. You can choose.
Allow it to happen. You know.
Is it important to choose? Is it important?
Yes, because we were given free will. You can read that in the Bible. People, they come to me and say, how can there be a God when people are starving? There's wars. Please, please, who made the choice to go into war? Who made the choice that not that those people in Africa should not have anything for everything they provide for us? And so forth. We have the choice in everyday life to go in and say, do I really want to drink this coffee that is Indian? You know, I remember very much as a young person.
It's a holy Mystica coffee, you know.
I know, that's why I drink it, you know. That Bob Dylan, he had just made a new record company with, I think it was Columbia Records. And he had found out that in the same breath that he was singing about not going to war and against this, and he was standing up for peace, Columbia Records had a side business that was providing small pieces for bombs that was being thrown in Vietnam. So immediately he went into he went to the chief, and that was while he was really selling a lot of records. Said, "Listen, I cannot be part of this. How can I stand there singing about this, and you are providing bombs? That is not connected, you know." And he actually did something to it. And this, you should remember that, that Bob Dylan actually, you know, I'm not actually a Bob Dylan fan or something, but I really respect something like that because, you know, this is making a choice. And we can all do that. We cannot all know exactly that if I drink this or buy this, is that connected? So how should we?
Well, we can't be all healers, but everyone has a special talent.
We are all healers. That's real. I mean, when we make a choice to see another person as it really is, instead of seeing the fool or the, you know, we are actually doing some healing. Of course, we are not always able to do that because we have personalities also, and we have egos, and egos are very, very touchable, you know. And egos love drama, and we are all
potential. And egos love it very complex, and we live in a complex world, and I'm so a complex person, it's a very long way to get enlightened.
We are drama queens.
Yes.
In spe. And so we love that. Until we find out that it's not the road we want to go anymore. So we can start to make other choices and start to work our way out of it or try to transform it, even if it's sometimes difficult. But we can make the choice.
Yeah, I have here a quote from your last book, from this three books. The seer, he told about healing. Where is it? Here. When I heal, I give the people their freedom again. What does it mean?
So I, please, can you repeat that?
Yeah, when I heal, I help the people to get free, absolutely free. So something like this, he said. What
Who
does
said
it mean? The seer in... Maybe
now I understand. Yes. What he's given them back their freedom. That's what he's talking about. That he's somehow touching something in their so-called light bodies, where all the information about a human being is actually here in this incarnation. And that was how he worked through the etherical all the way. And so he tried to bypass, so to speak, personality. That was how I understood it in the end. I really understood that. And that was also because when people phoned one morning, for example, I was sitting there in the subject, some woman was starting, you know, "Oh, I have all these problems." And at that time, he just put down the phone and he was still talking. And he said to me, "Just take a look, I have to go to the toilet for a piss." And she was just, she thought that he was at the other end. And when he came back, he took it up and said, "Okay, I think that's enough. But 10 o'clock, if you're ready, I will provide the healing. Have a good day." So, of course, that was first time I experienced that with them. And I thought that was a kind of rude thing, maybe. So afterwards, when we had breakfast, I just asked him about it. He said, "Listen, am I a psychologist? No, I'm a healer. I don't need all this noise, because it doesn't matter if people have a bad knee or they have a brain tumor, I have to fix it." "Yeah, you agree?" he said to me. "Yeah, yeah, of course." So all this is just kind of holding on. I felt that this woman had been to many, many therapists before, repeating her story over and over again. That is her identity. We want to bypass that identity because that is connected to ego and personality. And I felt I could not reach her. So I had to bypass her. But I could not, you know, see, it was, and it was just, I thought, I can go to the toilet. I needed a piss, to be frank, you know. So he was very much, you know, on the spot, in the moment. He was connected to her. He was really there. And tried to, okay, she have to talk, but I don't need to listen to it because it, you know. So he tried to in that way. So he had a special treatment for everyone, just trying to connect to what is needed here and now.
Yeah.
He was not always right, and sometimes he was not able to do it.
But also he didn't see his as himself as a big master or something.
No.
Just doing his work.
That's, of course not. He was smoking and he was drinking, and sometimes after the book came out, there was people who wrote me, how can he be a holy man and he smokes and drinks? And he never ever pretended to be one. But nevertheless, he helped thousands of people.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So we have to, what do we mean by holy men and holy women? What is it, all this crap about being holy?
Yeah.
We are all holy if we want to. It's not a big thing.
So we don't need gurus and stories.
No, we need inspiration. And of course, when we meet each other, we can, you know, it can be an inspiration to meet other people.
Yeah.
You don't have to pronounce it. You don't have to advertise it. It's just be open towards other people and you learn from them.
Yes.
We learn from everybody.
Yeah.
So we are each one of us are teachers and pupils.
And also we learn from life every day, every second.
Yeah.
How can we find our path? How can we connect again to so-called God or to our holy self or something?
Sometimes be still and try to sit down and listen. And listen to all the noise that the ego is making.
Yeah.
I need to do this, I need to do that, I need to do that. I must remember this, you know. And it can be very hard, very difficult. That's a challenge, to try to get in and listen to the inner voice. What is it actually saying? What do you really want? Why are you doing what you're doing?
Mm-hmm.
You know? A lot of times we don't even aware of why we do things.
Yeah, that's right.
We do things because we think it's expected of us. We do things because we want to be loved, be appreciated. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's only natural when you are a human being.
Mm.
But sometimes you need to stop and just think, why? And because you feel, I cannot just go on doing this. I need to. So my experience for many people who have come to me, and also I've experienced with who approached the seer, is that you come to a crossroad in your life and, which way to go.
Yeah.
And sometimes, of course, you need help or inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
It can be from a book, from a talk, from whoever. Ah, yes, that resonates with something deep within me. Or you take what you would call the wrong turn and go down the wrong. But I don't think there's a wrong turn. There's not a wrong road. You felt in that moment you had to go down to experience something. And you find out later, it was a dead end. You come back and you know now, I'm not going back down that road anymore. There's only this road left now. So that's my road. You know, there's many ways to come
to this way, ourselves, to come to God. Yeah, we talked a little bit about Yeshua, the saints, Maria Magdalena, and wonderful stories, wonderful experiences. Is now Yeshua present in our life or here in the air? Some people say he reincarnates sometimes. Others say he reincarnates in everyone when we realize God in ourselves.
You know, maybe we should define what we mean by Yeshua, Jesus.
Yeah.
Because there's Jesus, the person, and there's the Christ, the translated kind of connected thing, you know. So it could be Christ consciousness, as it is called.
Yeah.
That everybody has, you know, again, Yeshua is saying, follow my example, you can do the same as me. And you can read he went up to the, what you call the Transfiguration, the mountain of Transfiguration it's called now, because he took some of his pupils up there and showed them how to be transfigured, how to mate with your higher self and your real purpose and your real being, your light being, your enlightened being. He showed them that. So they could see it can be done. Yeah. And I think that's what it is, you know. That's what the teaching all about. But Buddha did the same. A lot of teachers did the same. So I think we should be careful when I'm talking about Yeshua, it's because he had been such a huge inspiration for me.
Yeah.
And I have a connection to him through my former incarnation as an Essene myself. So of course, but other people have other.
Yeah, it's was not like the only one, the only teacher.
That's really, even I have been connected to rabbis in Israel, to whom, you know, rabbis and Orthodox Jews, you know, Jesus is really absolute zero. He's really, you have to avoid him. But they say, for example, one that I'm especially very fond of, he died a few months ago, Adin Steinsaltz. He said that, he was a great teacher, but he was not the only one.
Yeah.
But he was a great teacher. He was a great transformer. Mm. Yeah. And I really respect that, you know, because he was so clear also, and in his own way, you know, very, very connected, you know, to what I call, what we could call Christ or Buddha or whatever you want to call it. I don't care what it's called. I just know that you could also call it the presence, you know, the presence of what we would understand as God. It's everywhere. We can connect if we choose to.
In your books also the feminine principle is a very important theme, and of course Magdalena, who and in your book you describe wonderful the way of her initiation and her learning to realize also the goddess in herself. In church we never heard about that, but it's so important. So to realize what is the feminine principle, and do we have all to realize more and in a new way what that means in our life?
I think so. I think the time is ripe now that we really understand what the feminine principle is. You know, we used to be talking a lot about men or women, but this is about feminine and masculine. Of course it has something to do with men and women, but it's not what we are talking about now. We are talking about feminine and masculine.
And we are men, but we have also the feminine part in us.
You have a very, very wonderful German writer called Franz Alt. He made a wonderful book called Jesus the First Man. I don't know what it's called in Germany. I got it in the late 80s, I think, in Danish, somebody. And it was around the same
time. He has also wonderful white hair like you.
Okay. That makes me even more beautiful, huh?
No, but yeah, you're more beautiful. Wonderful.
But Franz Alt is, he's one of those who really got it, you know.
Yeah.
And at the
he's a warrior for peace, warrior for
For I really resonate. He meant so much to me when I think it was in 86 I was I opened up towards the Magdalene. Because I was very much into the scriptures, you know, old scriptures. And there was the Nakamadi scriptures, you know, with the Gospel of Thomas, Gospel of Philip, Gospel of Truth, and so forth. All the Gospels that didn't make it to the so-called Gnostic Gospels.
Yeah.
And I was had been waiting for years for the first official English translation of all those Gospels in one, from all the scholars that was connected to the manuscripts. And it was while I was reading the Gospel of Philip, and I stumbled on this saying that Mary the Magdalene was the disciple that Jesus loved the most and often kissed on the. And then there was a hole in the manuscript, and they put in brackets because to show we don't know, we cannot read that word.
Yeah.
So we don't know actually know what part of the body he kissed her on.
Yeah.
And I've never heard anything like that he was kissing anybody, and he was doing it very often, and to this woman, you know, nobody ever told me about it. So suddenly, I needed to understand what part of the body he was kissing her on. I mean, it could be on her cheek, or it could be on her belly, or whatever.
Yeah, I don't know.
But actually, in an old, it led me to an old Jewish scripture about customs at the time of Jesus, made by historian from the time of Jesus called Josephus, who wrote many thousands of pages of that period. And there you could read that he had been in a scene himself, you know, from that the kiss on the mouth was a way that initiated persons were recognizing each other and also revering each other. So you can imagine that them, what I found out later, obviously had to be married, because we can read in the New Testament that he was called a rabbi, Jesus, and he was going into synagogues and reading from the textures aloud, and you were only allowed to do that if you were an Orthodox rabbi, a real Orthodox rabbi. And if you were an Orthodox rabbi, you have to be married, or else you would not be accepted, you know? So through Henry Lincoln, the author of Holy Blood, Holy Grail, that book, that I was very, I met in France, and we were actually starting to work together to build up a manuscript around Mary Magdalene, and him being a Jew himself.
Dan Brown learned from him also.
But he being a Jew himself knew a lot about the customs. He was raised as a Jew. No, not many people know about it because he took another name. His family took another name because at that time they weren't very popular to be Jews, you know. So, but he was very, I was really, really surprised to know how much he knew about Jewish customs. Also for that time, he had been very much into that when he worked on the book on the Holy Grail. So it was very, very, very fascinating to work with him around that. And he had read my book on Magdalene, and that was how we were acquainted afterwards. So he was also the one who told me that Jesus actually have a twin brother. Toma, who means the twin, you know. So that there was actually, like Rudolf Steiner also had been into that, there was two Jesus children. And that is why there is two life trees. There's one in the Matthäus Evangelium and one in Lucas, you know. So it
is it more than a symbol, more than a metaphor?
Okay. There were two.
Okay, wow.
And, but that aside, back to the Magdalene, because that was really, really important. I also, so in my investigation, I also found in a very, very beautiful old Aramaic gospel a saying of Jesus saying that I am and my bride are one, just exactly as Mary the Magdalene, whom I have chosen as an example for myself, is one with me. He's saying everything there. He's saying that he's actually being connected to his inner bride, his inner feminine, and that in Mary the Magdalene he has found an earthly woman who mirrors that inner feminine side of himself. And that is why they have become one. You know, it's all there.
Sometimes I now think about Mona Lisa, Leonardo da Vinci, as maybe himself, but also a woman. It's both. It's wow, we feel this wonderful connection between man and woman, or female and male principle.
You know, we know today that Leonardo da Vinci was at least bisexual. He was also homosexual. But I have, for example, today many of my my friends, I have bisexual or homosexual friends that are living together as couples and have done for many years. And, you know, that I feel that now also with all this gender thing that has come in, you know, that you are, you know, even children are trying to announce. I feel like the opposite sex, or I'm both, and all these things. that it actually has something to do mm-hmm. with our evolvement, or yeah, how we as human beings yeah. evolved. Because we should remember, before we were born, we had both, you know.
We were a woman in a life before and something like this.
No, you know that we were actually, when we are on the other side,
yeah.
we are both nothing.
Ah, okay.
You know, like in Thomas, the Gospel of Thomas, actually Jesus is addressing this. He said, when man is not man anymore, when the masculine is just pure masculine mm. and the woman is not woman anymore, but when they two become one, then they shall enter.
Yeah.
How should we understand that? You can understand, and that's why I think that what Gustav Jung tried to give to us is
so that, anima,
to try to give it a new voice and address it to our times.
Yes.
That was really his big work, I think.
Yeah.
So I think there's so much to get from that.
Yeah. How can we more better understand this connection between the male and female concept? I think many people on the spiritual path nowadays think it's having to do with Tantra and coming with body to body, but maybe it's another understanding what we need.
First of all, Tantra in its original form is first and foremost consciousness.
Yeah, has nothing to do with so much sexuality.
But of course, I can understand that it's for a lot of people that's very interesting to go into, because I think we have been so estranged in our eras to what is sex really
it's life power.
No? What it's all about, you know. Yeah. And now it's turned into pornography in many ways. Everything is, you know, big boobies there, big boobies there, you know, if you want to sell something, you know, just put, or it can also be men, you know, half naked, you know, and, you know, like, you know.
Yeah, I read here that maybe it should be that the people, the humankind, go farther, more than, but many of them are stuck in here on blockade here and don't come into their heart because there's too much having to do with that. So
it's just again a projection and how we project. But I think when we are really feeling, when we can really feel connected to other person through the heart, first and foremost, then everything else is just a gift that goes with it.
Yeah,
but if we need to feel this connection, that is.
And also to realize that here is our center, the real center, isn't
also
it?
That like, you know, I and my bride are one. Exactly is like, you know, this woman. Because that's why I have chosen her to be an example to me.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah.
Because we are one.
Yeah.
So it goes both ways. We learn, you know, from each other. But it's not just like persons, it's also on a higher level that even when it's happening, maybe we understand it next year or something.
But
it's there. Yeah. And you should remember when, for example, in the Jewish tradition, even to this day, if you are going to mate in the bridal chamber, a man and a woman, and you can go in there and create and prepare the way for a new soul that is coming into in the world. But you can also mate, and they know that when you do it in consciousness and open-heartedness and love, you prepare the way for the Shekinah. The Shekinah being the feminine side of what we call God. You know, the Shekinah being the spirit that hovered over the waters when everything was created, as we can read in the Old Testament. So this is actually part of when every time we connect to something, somebody on a deep level, even, you know, it could be you and I now, here now, we create something on another level, on a higher level.
Yeah.
A child, so to speak, that has something to do with the meeting of you and me. And we cannot just leave it there without nourishing it, you know? So can you see now how we create a triangle between us?
Yeah.
That it's not just, we cannot just
not just two and two polarities, but the third is the child. Yeah. The third is what we create now. What?
We create something together between us.
Yeah.
And if it is, we want something of value, If it's something that means something, mm. it means also that we have to nourish it, mm. to take care of it. Yeah. Or else it will be just an orphan child. Mm. Who is going to take care of it? Hmm? We create so many wire protections and so many crazy thought forms. Yep. So actually, the seer said, the pollution of the world is yeah. very, very, of course, we need to take care of that. But there's another form of pollution, our thought forms.
Our thoughts.
What yeah. we project yeah, yeah, and yeah. keep on projecting. And
it's all connected.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's very difficult to understand it for many people, but it's all connected. I feel it also. I see yeah. it also. Yeah. Wow. Okay, I think this child, maybe you viewers feel what there we created. I would say we do a second interview. I'm very thankful, very great. I thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Have a good time. Wow, isn't it touching? Well, I'm touched. See you again to the second part.